the 19th century intellectual encounter between India and the West had set off a rush of remarkable intellectual creativity. Bengal was the center. This intellectual creativity, not least, had an influence on religion and led to the emergence of new forms of Hindu traditions and a revival or rebirth of some of the old traditions. Some of the sources for the renewal of Hindu traditions were new institutions of education and knowledge, responses to Christian missions, and Orientalist interests in ancient Indian traditions. The British and Orientalists' idea of a commonality between ancient India and the civilization of Europe, with the Sanskrit language as a key role in this commonality, indicated that ancient India was what matched Europe. And by restarting a tradition of ancient India in its Sanskrit form, equality with European civilization was in some sense perceived as achievable. Hariharānanda Sāṃkhyayoga seems to be part of this elevation of ancient India in order to attain greater dignity under colonial rule. Romantic views of the past and a view of the present as degenerative, but with a possibility of recovering the past and reactualize it by focusing on the ancient philosophical systems, seem to have been important elements for the restarting of the tradition of Sankhya Yoga. Western Orientalists thus contributed to changing the religions they studied. Āraṇya's restart of Sankhya Yoga represents one of the earliest manifestations of the revival of the texts of the Yoga Sutra in Bengal, where modern yoga is supposed to have originated, with the publication of Vivekananda's translation and commentary on the Yoga Sutra in 1896. The statement by Farquhar, quoted earlier, was quoted in introductions to several of the texts by Hariharānanda published by the Kapil Mutt. But in these texts, as late as 1912, was misquoted and replaced with as early as 1912. This gives a different meaning. Instead of seeing him as a late survival of classical yoga philosophy, he was an early representative of modern yoga. Hariharānanda was indeed an early representative of modern yoga. He was not a uniquely late representative of classical yoga, but a uniquely early representative of modern yoga. This change in the quote from as late as 1912 to as early as 1912 corrects the mistake made by Farquhar. Bhattacharya, who probably was the first in the Kapil Mutt tradition to misquote this, in 1977, certainly did not think Āraṇya was late but early. In the Orientalist Farquhar's statement, Āraṇya seems to be presented as coming from a tradition that was on the verge of dying out, an old Sankhya orthodoxy, and Āraṇya was one of the few or the only one left. In Kapil Mutt tradition's reading, on the other hand, Āraṇya seems rather to be an early representative of a new and emerging yoga tradition, a new orthodoxy, an early specimen of modern yoga. This is also the historical correct view. Hariharānanda Āraṇya is an interesting case because it illustrates how scholars have promoted a form of romantic misinterpretation. This form of romantic misinterpretation can be applied to many more cases than this. In scholarship can be detected a view of India as static and unchanging before modernity. And in popular culture, not only static and unchanging, but mystical and transcendent as well, with postulated ancient leftovers. However, creation of new orthodoxies is also a feature of modernity. The revival of yoga philosophy in Bengal in the second half of the 19th century and the early decades of the 20th was influenced by the interest of Orientalist scholars and theosophists in ancient traditions, by Indian intellectuals and a new Hindu movement of the last decades of the 19th century Bengal. In this new Hindu movement, people were looking for ways to revive ancient traditions instead of reform traditions, which had characterized the Bengal Hindu revival of the first part of the 19th century, dominated by Brahmo Samaj. This new confidence in the religious traditions among Hindu intellectuals was partly caused by the increased interests among some Europeans in ancient Indian languages and religious traditions. The interest in texts of ancient India among Orientalists such as Colebrook, Wilson, Ballantyne, and Max Müller, the reputed founder of the science of religion, and theosophists and Indian intellectuals, was combined with excessively romantic views about the Indian past and the Sanskrit language. These excessively romantic views about the Indian past and the Sanskrit language opened up areas of an imagined equality between India and European culture that contrasted sharply with the reality of the contemporary colonial situation. Dignity was to be found by reviving the past. Such equality and even Indian superiority were sought in a Sanskrit text of the Hindu traditions of religious thought. The yoga teaching of Āraṇya and the institution of Kapilmat represent a modern Sāṃkhyayoga tradition in a sense that it was a response to the search for a Puritan and ascetic Hindu philosophy that characterized the so-called Bengali Renaissance or the New Hinduism, or what we now see as part of early modern Hinduism. The activities of Orientalists and Theosophists generated a new interest in the Indian philosophical tradition. An intellectual approach to religion argued that the goal of religion was an experience, personal enlightenment, or self-realization, and that humans could attain the salvific goal without the help of gods. A rationalistic approach had a vision of India as a great ancient civilization whose message and ideals could be reenacted in a contemporary world. It led to new interpretations, but also to new forms of orthodoxy. The Bhadraloks, the rich and educated middle-class groups of the Bengali society, were influenced by European and American traditions, but they also reacted against them, and in the last quarter of the 19th century, increasingly so. In the 19th century in Bengal, there emerged not only Hindu reforms, but also new forms of orthodoxy. These new forms of orthodoxy, write William Halfas, were, quote, by no means a mere continuation of that which existed before the encounter with the West, end of quote. In this situation of the revival of yoga in Bengal, Hariharānanda's contribution was to place yoga in its proper Sankhya yoga context. He was part of the new Hinduism, often called the Hindu Renaissance, and now more commonly called modern Hinduism, which had the vision of a great ancient civilization of India that could be reenacted in the contemporary world. Hariharānanda differed from the teachers of early modern yoga as well as the later yoga asana teachers. He differed from the early teachers of modern yoga in his insistence on the Sankhya dualist philosophy as the doctrine of yoga. He differed from the teachers of later global yoga in that he did not teach or emphasize yoga asanas. According to Sankhya yoga, asana means being comfortably seated. While many founders of the yoga movement that have dominated the global yoga movement were interested in health, sports and gymnastics and developed yoga for that purpose. Worship of the body seems increasingly to characterize the global yoga phenomenon. Photographs of the yoga body dominate the yoga magazines and the instruction books. The emergence of this type of yoga as a cultural phenomenon seems to be not unrelated to the birth of the modern sports movement. The first modern Olympics was organized in 1896, the same year some researchers have claimed was the beginning of modern yoga, with the publication of Vivekananda's Raja Yoga. That yoga poster competition most probably in the future will become part of the competitive program in the Olympics seems to confirm this identity of modern yoga as related to modern sports. One photo displayed at Kapilmat of the young ascetic Hariharānanda is of him in Padmasana, with emphasis on strength, health and correct posture. But Hariharānanda seems also in his Sāṃkhyayoga practice to have disregarded the body, and none of his writings elaborates on asana practice. Hariharānanda mostly wrote on philosophy and on meditation and control of the mind. Sankhya yoga was for those who have already perfected asana in a previous life, argued Hariharānanda. The blending of Advaita Vedanta and yoga philosophy had been a trend in India since the 16th or 17th century, and in addition, Advaita Vedanta dominated a significant part of modern Hindu philosophy. Many of the Hindu teachers of modern yoga followed this philosophical interpretation. Advaita Vedanta has since the 20th century flourished in global Hinduism and in the global yoga movement as well. Academic studies of the history of yoga confirm that the blending of yoga philosophy and Vedanta is a later development in Indian philosophy, and that the yoga philosophy of Patanjali, Patanjala Sankhya, originated as an interpretation of Sankhya philosophy, as the teaching of Hariharānanda stated. Hariharānanda's commitment to Sankhya yoga made him choose to permanently enclose himself in a human-made cave, Kapil Guha. Hariharānanda did not consider the teaching of Sankhya yoga as a force that would transform society, but as a sadhana, a yoga practice for salvific liberation of the self from matter, and of interest probably only to a small number of people.